ASU's been involved in NASA space exploration missions for as long as NASA's been around. One of the attractions of coming to ASU was the history, the heritage, the great work that had been done by faculty and staff who'd been here a lot longer than me. Late Ron Greeley was instrumental in helping to train some of the astronauts and come up with the plans for the lunar orbiters and the surveyor missions and process some of that data and help to do the mapping that selected the Apollo landing sites and tried to figure out the geology of what's going on in those places. Early Mars missions, Mercury missions, Venus missions, you know, going back to the 60s and 70s. Phil Christensen picked up a lot of that mantle with his incredibly successful program of mostly infrared instruments. Mark Robinson and his group photographing the moon for a decade from up close and really revolutionizing lunar science, sharing that data with the public. Most of us on campus are not involved here, are not involved in the human exploration program, only secondarily. The history that ASU has is really on the robotics side.
Lunah-Map will be one of the next batch of deep space CubeSats. It's not a large data set, so we need to build that data set of missions that have the ability to execute a science mission in deep space. Moving forward beyond sort of Lunah-Map, I hope that this is the start of these secondary ride-alongs. You know, if NASA wants to go to Mars, there might be 10, 20 slots for small, individual, independent spacecraft that can conduct their own science mission either at Mars or go elsewhere and conduct some type of mission that's has this high-risk, high-reward science return.
I've been working with the Spirit and Opportunity rovers, which were very successful, the Curiosity rover, which is still going on Mars, and of course we're building the cameras for the new Mars 2020 rover, which doesn't have a name yet.
Working on Psyche mission is a crazy pleasure. And our team is now up over 600 people. We're scattered all around. We're at Jet Propulsion Laboratory and Maxar, and we're at different universities, and we're a bunch of private companies. So much of the reason that we know how to put together complicated missions like this was learned through the Apollo system. I mean, you think about it, how did we as humans figure out how to build a system that's so complicated that no single person understands it, and yet it has to work flawlessly? In this day and age, we really believe and understand the value of diverse teams. And so that's one of the pleasures we're going to see as we return to the moon again, is there are going to be all kinds of people going to the moon, not just the men, the heroes of the Apollo era. Now everybody gets to be a hero.
At ASU, we thought, well, if we're going back to the moon, we're going to need to train astronauts again. So what we're doing is we're building, and it's done, an Earth equivalent of a lunar rover to train astronauts to work on the moon. And ours is called Tycho, after the Tycho crater. Tycho has more capability. The tires can rotate 90 degrees, so it can crab walk, and there's other capabilities that rover didn't have. We could test it here, but up in Flagstaff, we can go to areas where they trained Apollo astronauts, show off the capabilities of this new rover. Ultimately, we're talking with folks at Johnson Space Center, and they want to borrow it. It will be able to be driven remotely by someone on the Earth, or maybe even someone in orbit around the moon. We have to learn how to control it, because we've never built anything like this before. So it's a learning process. It's great to see it moving.
It's just a great environment for faculty colleagues who are working literally all over the solar system, staff supporting all that activity, and students who are doing their thesis work or capstone project work, laboratory work, meteorite work. Just the breadth of the work that goes on here in planetary exploration at ASU is remarkable.